My paper is a critique. Much of my work is a critique. I have used this value more than anything else. And I think it's important to bring about discussion of things that the government does or other academics do and to engage with the debate. I was hoping that Nadeem Ul Haq would have been there, but perhaps somebody else who represents the Planning Commission can talk about this. And had they read Dr. Irfan Ul Haq's paper, I think my paper would have been redundant. Because I think, as he says, that a lot of the things that he suggested in the central jobs approach are more doable than what the Planning Commission talks about. There have been a number of interventions by this government since it came to power in 2008. The 18th Amendment, the 7th National Finance Commission Award, India-Pakistan trade, all of which we are talking about tomorrow. It's made other interventions as well. And the Pakistan Framework for Economic Growth, or the new growth strategy, which the Planning Commission launched last year, exactly 1 year ago, is going to be one of the most forgettable ones that it has made in the last 4 years. I think it's, I'm going to talk about it in a little bit of detail. And I find very serious flaws and problems with the framework. I think it's highly self-congratulatory and self-promotional, and sort of offers substance which I think perhaps should have been rethought. And after 2008 and the global crisis, there is a rethinking about what economics does, what political economy does, and I'll be talking about some missing aspects of political economy and the absence of consideration of a lot of issues which would make the growth framework work. It's exactly 1 year, May 28, 2011, when the new growth strategies, or as called the Pakistan Framework for Economic Growth, was launched by the Deputy Chairman and the Planning Commission. And my paper is based on all their publications and a lot of material on the website. And now, this new age of blogs, there are lots of blogs and you know, what people have thought about it. And also a very lively email exchange with Nikal Ahmed, Arif Zulfikar, maybe some of you over here, people who I don't know, but there was a very lively email exchange in this new way of discussing documents. So it's based on that. The title of my paper, Captivating Vision of the New Growth Strategy, is actually drawn from what's posted on the Planning Commission's official website. That's how it calls itself. By someone who doesn't have a name, it's called Consultant to the Planning Commission. And he or she, since now we have a lot of women economists and consultants as well, argues that this, the Planning Commission offers a very captivating vision for the future of Pakistan. I actually feel that that's not very captivating, and that's what my paper is based on. So this new growth strategy which the Planning Commission has come up with, I think is a welcome addition in the debate for addressing the exact sort of problems that Irfan Haq was talking about. But one assumes that there is an old growth strategy which the Planning Commission's new growth strategy is replacing. But rather than referring to something called a traditional planning approach, and I'm not sure which tradition they're talking about, how one goes, because there are some very good traditions as well. But other than dismissing a traditional planning approach, the new growth strategy doesn't talk about the old growth strategy. It just sort of says that, you know, the old growth strategy was bad, the new growth strategy, and everything that happened was traditional. I'll talk about the traditions in a little while. What does the Planning Commission want? What does the framework say? I'm just looking at how what does the Planning Commission say? So I'll summarize some of the key points of this new growth strategy, which I found in greater detail in the paper. The new growth strategy says, and of course one agrees with a lot of things that it says. It's not completely out of the blue. It says that there's been a decades-long struggle with macroeconomic stabilization arising from unsustainable fiscal policies. I think we saw evidence from that, of that from Irfan Ul Haq's paper. There's demographic pressure. It used to be called the demographic dividend, but now it's called demographic pressure. There's a legacy of economic distortions. I think Planning Commission means government intervention. In fact, there's an impact of external events like earthquakes, floods, continuing long-standing low-intensity conflict. There's a large and loss-making public sector which is said to impede market development, a low and declining productivity, and it talks about a better life under a democratic government. It does recognize that this is a democratic government, and there is a sort of political sort of anger to all that. But that's something that finishes in the end. Perhaps for these reasons, the Planning Commission believes that, and I quote, our growth experience of the last four decades has been volatile annual growth and a declining trend in long-run growth patterns. In addition, productivity growth has been lower in comparison to our competitors. For the last 4 years, per capita incomes have not increased in real terms, while double-digit inflation has prevailed. Our growth policy has been based on public sector projects and arbitrary incentives. The project selection process has been poor and so on and so forth. Hence the need for a new approach to accelerating economic growth and sustaining it. I don't think anybody could disagree with the fact that there is a need to rethink growth, to think about new growth strategies. My question, my problem is the strategy which the Planning Commission has devised. In its brief assessment of what constrains Pakistan's economic growth, the framework argues that this is primarily on account of inadequate market development and lack of efficient public sector management. There is a lack of core governance. Markets have not been allowed to develop, and investment has not been allowed to take place because markets have not been able to develop. And there is a need to promote deepening of physical, human, and social infrastructure. Of course, one can agree with a lot of these. The new growth strategy focuses on a number of areas. Productivity is one such area, where labor productivity in particular, and I think some people are talking about that, is a significant weakness. The framework identifies a number of reasons for this, which include market quality, poor governance, limited urban development, and so on and so forth, and the need for better government. The Planning Commission considers poor governance and dysfunctional markets to be among the most important reasons why growth in Pakistan has not achieved sustained acceleration. We didn't hear any mention of dysfunctional markets or poor governance on the basis of the guided Dr. Farhan's paper, but this is the emphasis of the Planning Commission. The new growth strategy relies heavily on vibrant and competitive markets. Openness and city development, I think again, one can't disagree with that. And it talks about creative cities, talks about connecting to compete, and so on and so forth. This growth strategy is to be implemented through what the Planning Commission calls results-based management, which will monitor and put in place an evaluation system which will oversee the main features of the growth strategy for which a number of guidelines have been provided. So to summarize, the Planning Commission has rethought the traditional growth narrative, gone toward what it was, except perhaps too much government, and feels that Pakistan has more of a software problem, which is management and productivity, rather than the shortage of hardware, which is physical infrastructure. You just wrote about the power crisis, which we constantly need reminding of. The strategy emphasizes the need to reduce economic distortions, improve functioning of domestic markets, create space in cities through proper zoning, and the private sector must drive economic growth with timely implementation of market reforms, which should promote competitiveness. So the main basis of the Planning Commission's new growth strategy is that private sector has to take the lead, it dominates the public sector, and I have some problems with that, which I'll talk about now. While attempts to develop new ideas which lead to ways of enhancing and sustaining Pakistan's growth rate beyond the roller coaster, topsy-turvy, at times dismal economic performance need to be encouraged, not just in the Planning Commission, but also in academic institutions like the Lahore School of Economics, and the growing mushrooming of donor-funded and supported think tanks, there are a number of unanswered questions which have been unaddressed in the framework from the Planning Commission. Perhaps most importantly is the absence of any analysis of what explains Pakistan's fast economic growth performance. We are not told what the old growth strategy is, but for anyone who is familiar with Pakistan's economic performance, in the last 65 years, there have been many periods, from 5 years to 8 years to 10 years, the 8 or 9 years, where growth has been very high. I think it's important to explain why that growth was high. With the same sort of physical infrastructure, the same sort of governance issues, the same terrible governance issues which have been identified, Pakistan has achieved very high growth, beyond 6%, 7% for 5 or 7 periods of time. I think it's very important, before we move on to new growth strategies, to understand and explain why growth was high. Was it just good civil servants? Was it a lot of aid, as Rashid Amjad's work has shown? In the 1960s, it was aid which helped growth a great deal. I think there's a need to examine those factors before one dismisses them. The Planning Commission's papers on the website do not do that. Why did the old growth strategy work when it did? What should have accepted an honest answer before the old strategy was scrapped? There was and continues to be a need to examine what works and what doesn't, what succeeds and what is failed. The crisis that Arun Haki spoke about and which we all read about is more recent, at least the recent cycle, the recent crisis is more recent. It's a recurrent crisis, whether because of balance of payments. But there have also been periods where the growth setup has worked very well. And there have been reasons why it has not worked. And I think one needs to differentiate what they are. I don't think it's a matter of software or hardware. I think there are underlying political economy reasons. Maybe military government is better. Perhaps one doesn't say that anymore, but if you look at the growth record, that's the simplifying assessment of why growth has been high, which leads to lots of other things, stability and so on and so forth. But that's not something that I support. Looking at the documents by the Planning Commission, there is a very clear pro-market orientation, an unfettered, naked pro-market orientation, without looking at whether what the role of the state has been. I think it used to be fashionable some years ago to dismiss the role of the state completely, but even in Chicago, where Friedmanite economics has undergone some rethinking after 2008, I think the pro-market orientation of interventions everywhere, in Europe, in the US, has had a rethinking, not in the case of the planning commission. I think the assumption that the private sector alone is going to lead Pakistan's growth problems is a bit exaggerated. Increasingly, economics has shifted from hardcore numbers to looking at institutions, political institutions, social institutions. I think there are more and more prominent economists who are looking at what is the relationship between inclusive growth, inclusive political institutions. This recent book by James Robinson and Asimekru, for example, looks at why nations fail. And they're all looking at how growth can work. It's not looking at just infrastructure issues, but looking far beyond that. I think one of the problems with the framework provided by the Planning Commission is that it overlooks a number of very important aspects. It does mention them, but does not give them the significance that they require. The Deputy Chairman of the Planning Commission states that the media in Pakistan is not discussing the important subject of growth. And instead, we find media and experts discussing issues like the tax to GDP ratio and the sovereign economy, whereas there are many other important issues to discuss, like growth and creating opportunities for the youth in the country. End of quote. He continues, and this is all based in the Planning Commission report, that we have a resource gap in our country. This is the Deputy Chairman of the Planning Commission. But there are resource gaps everywhere. It is not a question of resources, but to recognize ourselves, reorganize ourselves, and think differently. This is a quote from the Deputy Chairman of the Planning Commission as part of this exercise. Clearly, this is my opinion, clearly, to dismiss the resource gap and not to put the diminishing tax to GDP ratio, which has fallen from almost 12% in 1999 to nearly 8% in 2012, at the forefront of any discussion of reform, really does undermine any sense of honest appraisal that the framework and the new growth strategies try to sidestep. Thinking differently, as the Deputy Chairman of the Planning Commission says, without a revenue base, certainly a novel way to articulate Pakistan's growth strategy. I think there is a need to rethink growth in Pakistan and to understand where it has failed and why it has not been able to continue beyond maximum of 5 or 6 years. And I think that, whether as Farhan Haq's work showed, that perhaps it's not the tax to GDP ratio alone, perhaps it is a growing fiscal crisis, perhaps it is, as the Planning Commission says, the absence of markets. But I think that Pakistan is one of those countries where markets have been allowed to function, especially compared to India, for example, or foreign direct investment has had better terms than others. So obviously there's something else explaining the absence of growth. It's not the free market, private sector constraints which limit the growth in Pakistan. To return to physical infrastructure, I mean, this is a point which is made numerous times in the Planning Commission document, that this is a question of software, it's not a question of hardware. It's not physical infrastructure, it's the quality of governance, for example. Ajay Chipper, I think, used to work for the World Bank, and who's also quoted and gave a keynote address at the Planning Commission, where I think some of you were also present, has argued that the Growth Commission, which was set up some years ago, has shown that 13 cases of sustained high growth, those countries which have had high growth of more than 7% for 25 years or more, have found that the single most important role was for infrastructure in high growth economies. Infrastructure seems to be very critical for high growth. You cannot have high growth without infrastructure. It is not clear how the free market private sector will play a big role in infrastructure development in Pakistan. We've seen what happened recently with the rental power projects and others. There is a problem of, you know, what role the private sector plays and whether one needs further dams, what sort of initiative one needs. Perhaps in Korea, in Turkey, this may be the case where the private sector take the lead. But in Pakistan, I think it is improbable that the private sector is going to take the lead to develop major infrastructure projects to be able to enhance and to stimulate growth. A specialist from the World Bank has argued, and he has said, and I quote, the proposed strategy of relying upon the private sector to make necessary infrastructure investments because the public sector essentially has no funds is essentially a cop-out. It dodges the real issue, how to create the necessary fiscal space and make the essential public expenditure choices that are the duty of any responsible government. Fascination with the private sector initiatives as a solution to all problems also reminds me of the World Bank's monumental policy mistake along the same lines, something it has been forced to reverse recently after more than a decade of costly errors. I think the Planning Commission is still behind this time. Let's bring in the issue of politics into this. What does one mean by politics? What does one mean by political economy perspective? I don't see how the private sector or the free market is going to address issues of provincial inequality, regional inequality, income inequality. There doesn't seem to be a sense in this document, which I presume many of you have read and have opinions on that as well, and perhaps some of you have also participated in it. But I think the whole issue of not just growth, but the issue of distribution, if growth does take place, what is the nature of that distribution? How does the state sector, what kind of role does that play? That's not discussed. There is an implicit assumption that the private sector will take care of distribution, whether regional or inequality also. Cities are a very important factor. They play a major role in the Planning Commission's document. Creative cities, I think, is the term that the Planning Commission uses. I think that's fairly understandable as you look at Pakistan's urban-rural spread. And now, I think, according to some demographers, about 55% of Pakistan is already urban. There's some discussion and debate about that, but the numbers are at least equal to 50% urban and 50% rural. It's clear that cities have become the motor and will become the motor of economic growth. But it's how the Planning Commission imagines what Pakistan's cities are like. For example, there's a complete resentment and dismissal of something called the informal sector. For anyone who's familiar with Pakistan, we know that the informal economy is probably twice the size of the formal, at least equal to the formal. The informal settlements in Pakistan, anyone who's familiar with cities in Pakistan, and Naveed Hamid and others have worked on cities in Pakistan, would know the work of Arif Hassan and Tasneem Siddiqui, for example, who have shown how dynamic informal sectors are, because they're unregulated, and of course they're under the table, under the map, and that's one reason why the tax-to-GDP ratio is low, and there are many others as well. But the Planning Commission completely dismisses informal sector growth, informal settlements in urban cities as an eyesore. There's one quotation from, I think it was a commissioner from Islamabad, and who wants all cities in Pakistan to look like Islamabad? I hope Pakistan never looks like Islamabad. But he says that Islamabad is considered to be one of the best developed cities in Pakistan, but because of slums coming up and informal development taking place around it in the recent past, it is not that Islamabad which was dreamed of at the time of planning. This is precisely the point that the informal sector is going to emerge where all cities exist because they are dynamic hubs. You cannot ignore the informal sector. In fact, I think, as I said, research from Karachi and other cities has shown, it is the informal sector which brings about that dynamism. Also in the economy, how you make the formula is a very different thing. How you bring them into the tax net is something very different. But it's something that needs to be considered. There is this bias in the census. Almost, I would call it a very first world bias in some ways, as far as cities are concerned. The examples that many of the participants of seminars and conferences have given, they said, why can't Pakistani cities be like the Middle Eastern cities? And 80+ Pakistan doesn't have oil. That's one explanation. Maybe there are other explanations. But I think one needs to understand why Pakistani cities are the way they are, why they function, and what can be made out of them. How, what is the growth motor and how it can be cultured? I can conclude with a few broad comments. A private sector led, free market oriented, new growth strategy, which does not directly take on issues of tax evasion by the same private sector which is supposed to be that engine of growth. This is also important. It talks about the private sector leading growth, which is fine, but it does not talk about how one taxes the private sector. It does not talk about, even if the private sector is an important growth, and there's no denying that. I think the public sector has suffered, private sector universities have flourished, private sector, the private sector has flourished in every sphere. It's important that it is developed. But it's also important to have strategies to be able to tax that private sector so that issues of distribution, resources, regional inequality, and so on are taken care of. So this, the Planning Commission's report sort of protects, in some ways I would argue, subsidizes the private sector and the elite by not suggesting how they should be taxed or whether they should be taxed. I can only assume that they should be taxed, but if you're talking about private sector growth, if you're talking about growth, it's important to talk about distribution as well. How does this growth manifest in its different forms? Similarly, by undermining, dismissing the significant, though wavered role of government and the state, the Planning Commission does a disservice to it, to its own growth strategy, and also exposes ideological moorings, which at least globally have been beaten into a different shape following the 2008 global crisis. The Planning Commission, with its gung-ho private sector and free market ideology, is way out of step with even those who defend the private sector and the free market. And I think it's important, it's critical that the free market and the private sector play a role, but to dismiss the role of the government, even a government which is which has a different sort of record from the past and keeps changing, I think needs to be reformed. By ignoring central issues related to politics and the articulation of power, and of issues which fall in the realm of political economy, the Planning Commission writes a highly technicist script which has little value in the messy world of real politics. Anyone can come up with a very technical report, you know, whether it's industrialization, whether it's the power sector, whether it's taxation. Unless you acknowledge the fact that there are vested interests, unless you acknowledge the fact that in democracy there are certain things that you cannot do under military governments, even military governments try to fail to raise the tax rate. In fact, it's been falling since then. So there are issues of political economy which need to be incorporated by the Planning Commission. One would expect that from an institution of the government which looks at political issues as well as economic issues. Issues of distribution and of inclusive institutions for growth are overlooked. It is exactly 1 year since the launch of the framework for economic growth. Perhaps it is these reasons why no one talks about this new growth strategy anymore. Like many ill-designed technical reports and strategies, lacking much context to the society in which it is supposed to be placed, this report too, fortunately, lies buried in the pile of reports and strategies devised by such institutions. Using the same principles of results-based management, which this report insists is how one should evaluate everything that happens in Pakistan, this new growth strategy is to be, how it is to be implemented, and following its distaste for government and its penchant for the private sector, perhaps one lesson after 1 year of the new growth strategy teaches us is that it is the Planning Commission itself which needs a revamp and a different orientation. One less ideologically blinkered and more in tune with Pakistan's actually existing conditions, its problems and its reality. Thank you.